Ladies and gentlemen, welcome today at another session of Room for Discussion. Klaas Knot, the president of the Nederlandse Bank, stated on the Sustainable Finance Seminar last year, "We have been occupied by the global financial crisis and its consequences for financial stability and economic growth. Now that the worst seems to be over, we have to carefully consider the future. It is evident to me that a stable financial industry and sustainable economic growth are only possible if we integrate sustainability into our operations and business models. Today, we will discuss whether finance indeed needs to incorporate sustainability into its practice. Moreover, we will discuss what the definition of sustainable finance is, what its role will be for our society, and if it's mere window dressing. We have the pleasure to discuss this today with two very interesting guests. On the right-hand side, we have Peter Blom, the CEO of Triodos Bank, which ranked second in the Eerlijke Bankwijzer last year. Led by Blom, the Triodos Bank has been growing rapidly the last years. And moreover, he is the founder of the Global Alliance for Banking on Ethical Values. Our other guest is Roel Beetsma, and we are very happy he is replacing Marleen Jansen-Groesbeek, who could not be here today, unfortunately. Roel Beetsma holds the MN-sponsored chair in pension economics here at the University of Amsterdam. MN manages the pension of three large pension funds, together worth more than 120 billion euros. Moreover, he is the vice dean of this faculty. You can Twitter with hashtag RFD, and you can ask your questions with our lovely lady, Emily, in the back. Give a warm applause to our two guests today.
Gentlemen, welcome on my behalf as well to today's discussion. First of all, we're going to concentrate a little bit on your background, what you do, what your mission is. And after that, we're going to focus on the societal role of sustainable finance. Mm-hmm. And after that, we will focus on what the role of the banks are within sustainable finance. And we will conclude the interview with the question whether sustainable finance is a new standard in finance. To start with you, Mr. Blom, before you joined the Triodos Bank, you helped running one of the first organic restaurants within the Netherlands. What was the moment you decided, I'm going to change my career and I'm going to help financial institution?
Well, it's quite interesting. That restaurant needed a loan. And I found out there was a Triodos Foundation, not a Triodos Bank yet. Mm-hmm. That was back in the 78, 79. And the Triodos Foundation was focusing on sort of being an intermediary between people who have a little bit of surplus money and initiative like the restaurant I was running who need money. Mm-hmm. And they helped us, and they told me we are going to set up a bank. And I thought, well, that's quite interesting work, all these initiatives working positively mm-hmm. for the future, how can I help? And then I thought, well, maybe I can become a volunteer of that organization. So I started as a volunteer at the Triodos Foundation.
As a volunteer of the bank or the organization?
The foundation, not yet the bank. And then the bank was created, and I joined the bank, so a long time ago.
And then you were part of the bank. What was your mission within the first years you joined this bank?
Well, for me personally, the mission was that I very much felt an entrepreneur. I liked very much to run a culture center and restaurant. I found that economics in practice and mm-hmm. learning actually much more than in university, I must admit. It was fantastic to do that. At the same time, I also felt you don't do it for yourself. An entrepreneur is only working for him or herself, was not my ideal. How can I help society to make the next step? And in that combination, I found Triodos a very nice place to help all these initiatives who are working on that future. So that's why I decided.
And then you wanted to become a banker, you thought.
Then I thought banking is not so bad after all. But I started as an entrepreneur and I had to learn banking. And then I thought banking is actually quite interesting. You are connected to a lot of initiatives. Money is the mirror of almost any transaction or any relation in society. So if you are part of that world and can help initiatives to grow and to blossom. That's a fantastic job.
Yeah, great.
Now, 30 years later, you're the CEO of the organization you once was inspired by. Is the mission of this Triodos organization, which is now a bank, still the same as 30 years ago?
Fundamentally, it is. Yeah, it was in 1980, it was about dealing consciously with money. That was our motto. And I think today it's even more true. If you see everything what's happening around us, people want to deal more consciously with money. And I think it has changed very for the positive. Mm-hmm. Today, with modern technology, modern media, people want to know what's happening with the food they eat, what's happening with politicians, what's mm-hmm. happening with their money in the bank account. That wasn't the case in 1980. It was a real small group who looked at that. Today, it's much more mainstream almost, I would say. Yeah. So it's going the right direction.
Yeah, we see the sustainable finance getting more popular. We're coming back to that. Mr. Batesma, you are investigating pension funds mostly, which tend to have a long-term horizon. Mm-hmm. Do you get a lot of in touch with sustainable finance in your research?
Not specifically, but it is true that pension funds, they invest, they get money contributions from workers, and they invest that specifically for the long run. They invest in public debt, but also other fixed interest instruments. Also invest in stocks, and they intend to buy and hold these instruments. And I think that makes them kind of good shareholders. They have a long-term interest. Usually they also have quite big packages, especially the big pension funds. And so they can exert also some influence on what companies are doing. So it's I don't work specifically on sustainable finance, but I see a lot of connections between sustainable finance and what pension funds are doing and what their intention is.
And do you see also a trend that they are more actively involved and pushing for better standards at where they're investing into?
Yes, that is something that you see very explicitly. I'm also a supervisor of a pension fund, not managed by MN, but in another pension fund, the Detailhandel. And like I think many big pension funds, they have also rules on corporate, maatschappelijk verantwoord beleggen, so
social responsibility
rules. And this takes an explicit role in the discussions that we have. And we do this very seriously. It's not window dressing. It's really doing this very seriously. We look at what are we investing in. There is also a firm that we outsource this to investigate, what we invest in. Are these firms that are they not involved in weaponry or other kinds of things that we don't want to invest in?
And is it something new that you're really having the focus on that?
I think this is a trend of maybe the past 10, 20 years. And it's a trend that is becoming bigger and bigger. And I'm pretty sure that many of the large pension funds do it in some way like this.
Now, we will talk about this trend later on as well. Mr. Blom, you're also the co-founder of the Sustainable Finance Lab. What is it which made you make this Sustainable Finance Lab
Be founded.
That was just after the financial crisis, and I think there was a lot of questions among citizens. What the hell was going on in banking? Mm-hmm. They had to be helped by government. We all know those stories. And what we felt from Triodos, being in the financial sector and at the same time looking in a different way at finance, that we felt the discussion, the dialogue between particularly science, economists, and banking was not taking place. Mm-hmm. So we invited a number of people from the scientific world and said, well, why don't we discuss more in depth what's actually going on from an economic perspective, mm-hmm. and then start a discussion not only with the banking sector, what we did, but also with citizens, with politicians, and to have an open debate. And we started these open debates in the city of Utrecht, and there was a lot of interest. We could only host 250 people, but there were 1,100 plus to 1,500 people who wanted mm-hmm. to come there and really debate what was going on. And I think today, Sustainable Finance Lab is really trying to help to connect the finance world, also the pension world. There is also a sustainable pension mm-hmm. lab created, what is a sort of part of the mm-hmm. SFL, where many pension funds are also quite interested to discuss what is sustainability and what is the connection.
Is it only about the discussion itself, or are also about coming up with a conclusion, a product?
No, I think if you look at science is to reflect on what's happening. Mm-hmm. And then I hope that my colleagues in the banks use that reflection to come up with new products and new services.
Are you using it?
Or new behavior. Absolutely, we are looking at it as well. Although we are sort of the initiator, and hope actually that some of the things we do also be taken over by other banks.
Could you give an example?
Well, one of the examples, we introduced 2 years ago a sustainable mortgage, and we made it very simple. We said, if you have a better energy label, mm-hmm. then you get a discount on your interest rate. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So very simply, if you have a C label, what is the sort of the standard, what's in average, mm-hmm. then you get the market rate. But if you have a B label, you get 10 basic points, 0.1% mm-hmm. Discount, and with A, even more. And we felt we can do that on our own as Triodos, but we felt this should be a standard product in the market. And so I invited my colleague banks, why don't you start this sort of mortgage
is
as well?
Is it a profitable product for you?
Absolutely, yeah? Absolutely, because we believe that there is enough room in the market, particularly in the mortgage market, to differentiate, to make that much more a conscious product. Yeah. And the beauty of it, that also the people who have such a mortgage save even also on their energy bill. So altogether, it's a very interesting proposition. And you know, we Dutch people, we like sustainability, but some extra is always nice.
Yeah, it's not only popular sustainable finance in academics, but we also see consumers are more and more concerned with it. Mm. And maybe that's a good start for our first topic, the societal role of finance. We've seen that a lot of consumers did go to ASN. Triodos has been growing rapidly. I think in 2015 they had 15% more customers, but also ING last year they introduced green bonds. Mr. Batesma, can you explain why this trend is so sustainable finance is becoming more and more popular?
I think it's, well, I'm not able to point to specific factors, but I think one of the reasons is that communication goes faster and that we can more easily see what is happening in the world. So you can more easily see if, for example, products are not produced in a decent way, then I think, you know, 30 years ago it was easy to hide this. I think nowadays this is no longer possible. Communication goes faster, we know better what is happening, and I think a lot of people, we are not only out there to what we call maximize our utility in the sense of getting as many goods as possible for the lowest price, but I think the average person doesn't want to spend money on products that are produced in a filthy way. Yeah. And as I was saying, 30 years ago we did not know, but now we know quite well what is produced in a decent way and what is not produced in a decent way.
And you also see that more transparency in the banking sector, also in financial institutions, that it's easier to see where they're investing into.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, now we have all the talk about the Panama Papers, and and also this has, I mean, communication goes much faster. Also this has then the effects on, you know, how governments, what governments are doing. I think it will influence, know, there was the case, I think the case of ABN AMRO. And, you know, people may not like this and this may influence the policies of the banks.
So the communication is better, transparency is higher. Ms. Blom, how can you explain that your clientele basis has been growing with 15% last year? Why is your bank becoming more popular?
Well, I think it's a little bit what Roel was saying is actually what we do. We communicate about what we do. We introduced some years ago that all the projects and businesses we finance are on our website. So we had a long discussion about how can we explain to people which criteria they have to comply with, very technical discussions, and then we decided in the end to combine the Google technology with the fact that we know all our projects. Let's combine it, go to the website. If you're a depositor in our bank, you can see where we are. That is facilitating a discussion on really show it and prove it what you're doing. And it's not so that everybody agrees with what we finance. Mm-hmm. I mean, some vegetarians don't like that we do organic meat, mm-hmm. for example. And there are other, but that's exactly the discussion you need to have.
Yeah.
What are the reasons? What diversity can we allow? But always the value proposition in the back of our mind and be completely transparent. Then you have a proper discussion.
Let's have this discussion right now. Because your communication or the communication of the users bank is quite straightforward. You only invest in projects which benefit the environment and people. So when we look at sustainable finance, what is, in your view, the best definition of sustainable finance?
The best definition of sustainable finance, in my view, is that you include people and planet in every decision you make. So we feel we are not an agent of our shareholders, we are an agent of society, including our shareholders. And that perspective is every moment in what we do. So our sort of loan officers, when they look at a loan application, they first ask the question, how can society benefit from that?
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, it has to be bankable and a good enterprise and so forth and so on, but not the other way around.
Mm-hmm.
We start with that broader context, what I think is a particular thing banks should do more and more, because banks have that overview. Banks have that role, and because they have that responsibility, they also have to be completely transparent and accountable to what they do.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I mean by sustainable finance.
Sustainable finance is the balancing between people, planet, profit.
Include them. I would not even say balancing, because if you say balance, you say, well, there's a trade-off, and I don't believe in the trade-offs. Mm-hmm. I believe in the integrated approach, where there are always dilemmas, and you have to discuss them, but you should not, from the start, say, there is a balance. It's something integrated.
Do you agree the definition, Mr. Batesman?
Well, I'm less of a specialist. So I, when I got the invitation to come here, I went to the internet to find a definition of sustainable finance, and I was not really able to find a specific definition.
Sure, yeah.
And the way I interpret it is, I think largely in the way Mr. Blom also interprets it, sustainable also means often, you know, for the longer run. So you do things that benefit, that are beneficial from the perspective of the longer run. And so you avoid, for example, as shareholders, you avoid short-termism. And that was also why I was talking about pension funds as potentially good shareholders. So we care about the long run. That means that you also include effects of investments on the environment. And I think this is important, because in the longer run, if we don't take care of our environment, then for sure we will have a lot higher costs, because we have to clean up the mess. And if you take a long run perspective, I think that helps in a lot of ways. Also involving people, also involving, it can be made quite broad.
But do you agree on the definition that the long run needs to incorporate society as a whole and not only your shareholders?
I think I agree to that. I think it's probably not always easy, because it depends on the type of shareholders you have, and in many instances, shareholders are quite short-termistic, and so they want profits in the short run. They want its stocks to go up in the short run, and as a firm, you have to deal with it, because if you alienate those shareholders, you have to find new shareholders. So it's not easy, I think.
The other definition which we encountered, apart from people, planet, profit, is also a more stable financial sector. Is the definition you gave, Mr. Blom, is that a precondition for a more stable financial sector?
I would turn it upside down. I think the financial sector will become more stable if they have a more inclusive approach.
Mm-hmm.
So I think to have a to sort of isolate the whole idea of a stable financial sector is well, theoretically very interesting. Yeah. But if you create a healthy relation between the real economy and the financial economy, you also create a more healthy financial system.
Yeah. Do you agree on that, Mr. Batesma?
I think so.
Where's your doubt?
Well, look, the thing is that if you look at the policies of, especially now, the ECB is really struggling with the environment of the low interest rate. And, you know, they're trying to, I mean, they have to keep inflation close to 2%, but on the other hand, they also look at the real economy. And I think the policies that they are following, they create instabilities in other directions, the so-called bubbles. So I think generally I agree with that, but I think it's not easy to kind of combine the two.
That's why
I agree with you, because actually there are other factors who influence the real economy in a way that actually is very hard as a bank to relate to become stable. If you see now exactly the ECB, what they're doing with throwing all this money on the real economy, hoping that we spend more and invest more, actually we don't see that happening as a bank. An entrepreneur only invests when there is a stable market, when there are stable circumstances.
And is it stable
and
enough
just,
now?
Just measuring on trying to influence that with lower interest rates is not going to help.
No. And is it stable enough now, you think?
I think the banks have become more stable as they have grown their equity, their capital base. I think that's healthy for a bank. And I think also risk management has improved. But that is still very much internal. The banks have to become more healthy, more resilient as banks. But I think the relation to society, what's happening there to the real economy, is not being solved yet. And that's always why I believe we cannot... We really have to change finance to finance change. Mm-hmm. I really like this expression from Achim Steiner from the UNEP. He said, well, if you really want to finance change as we need it in society, we also need to change finance, the financial system. No. So in that sense, it's also important to look at the broader system and see how we do that, including the ECB. Yeah.
And who is responsible for making this change happen? Is this the government, the ECB, the banks itself?
Well, I think hopefully, we work with a market, we are living in a market system, so hopefully change will also come from within the, within the banks themselves. And of course, and I think this is already happening because I think banks get also quite a bit of competition nowadays, for example, from pension funds, or this is increasing. As alternative providers of financing of mortgages and maybe financing of firms, so it already I think it's happening. But my hope is that it comes from within the sector, and of course we have the supervisors but they should, they should supervise, but they should not interfere too much. But one thing that is important is that much of the supervision has been geared towards, at the micro level, towards individual banks becoming, increasing their equity, etc. Well, I think the macro perspective is often a little bit lost. What we call the systemic effects, if something happens, that can affect the whole economy.
Yeah. And I would just like to get back to what you earlier said, is that you hope that it is coming from inside of the sector. But what you also said is before that shareholders mostly want short-term profit, which is not really the case when we look at sustainable finance, right? Yeah. Because this is profitable on the long term.
Well, I'm not saying there are shareholders that want profits in the short run. There are also shareholders like many institutional investors, among which you have pension funds, that are really looking at the longer run. But of course, if you are a pension fund and you invest a lot in equity and the value of your equity falls, then this has also repercussions for under our supervisory system. It may have repercussions for the contributions that people are making, or it may have repercussions for the pension benefits. I think it's pretty hard to stick to your long-term strategy, because in the shorter run you will always have those disruptions that stock markets fall and people become nervous and they say, okay, you have been following. We see the stock markets fall, the value of your pensions falls, you have been following a bad policy. Well, without taking into account the long run perspective.
Yeah, is this a role, Mr. Blom, for the government? They are, for example, making it attractive to invest in green bonds or green other investments. Is that something the government should do?
Well, I think it's always the order of things. It starts with the consumer, the people, and the business. They start to make other choices. And as a government, and to a certain extent also as banks and supervisors of banks, you can support that process. So by introducing the whole investing in green tax advantages we created in the 90s, I think that helped really to accelerate investments in wind energy at the time, in renewable energy. But that is a sort of push they give, and then markets start to take over, and then the subsidy or the tax advantage was lower, and now it can almost be done without tax. And that, I think, is a right way of government helping to mature markets, that they have to time the long-term perspective, and otherwise nothing happens.
So you mean the green investments have the same profitability as normal investments?
Absolutely. As now already, solar energy in the south of Europe is in competition with fossil fuels. Yeah. And even there we know there's a lot of subsidies as well. Yeah. People always think that renewable energies are subsidized, but coal is as much subsidized as renewable energy. So the clear picture about what is the real price hasn't been so clear in the past and is becoming more clear. That's a good development.
Thanks. What about the risk? Is the risk higher with green investments or?
No, I would say even less, because Why? This is where the future goes. Mm-hmm. And I would say, and that has been an interesting discussion with the stranded assets in Shell and other oil companies, that looked really as a real strong asset. But now the question is, can we ever get those resources out of the earth? Can we pump them up? I don't think so. And there suddenly you see there is a much bigger risk than we thought there was. Where with renewable energy, technology based, improving every year, and it has improved, I think that's a real sort of secure investment in that sense. So there's, I would say, less risk than there was in the past, certainly today.
One problem is the policies of the governments. In that, I think, in my perception, quite a few subsidies have been wrong directed, and then they have been turned back. Yeah. And I think, okay, it is wrong to give subsidies to the wrong causes, but it's also wrong to have a policy that switches back and forth. And I think the unpredictability of the government's policy is actually the biggest risk in this regard. Yeah. If you can count on a very long run policy regarding subsidies or regarding prices, then you can make the investments, because those investments are always for the long run. If you want to invest in solar energy, you earn it back over a period of maybe 20, 30 years. So you want to have a stable environment. And I think the biggest risks are actually coming from the government changing its policies back and forth.
So the stable environment is lacking from the government, you say?
Well, this is my perception, at least.
Is it the same for you as well?
That's true. I agree. I think it's... Many times I saw there was huge subsidies for renewable energy, and I said, please make it less but more stable. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's not the one shot now what helps. What really helps, even to say, well, it will lower in the next 10 years, that even helps. Yeah. Because then you have a predictability, and don't change it. Don't say after 4 years, we have another nice idea, let's do this one.
So it's not only the financial sector who is too much focused on the short term, but also the government.
Maybe even more.
Well, this is in a way it's automatic. One are the budgetary constraints of the government, because I think we started with subsidies that were kind of unlimited, no matter how many people made use of it. it turned out that, I mean, if you give subsidies, then of course people will try to get those subsidies. So the demand is pretty high, so they have to turn this back. And then on top of that, we have politicians that are elected every 4 years. And of course, they have, you know, they don't look any further than those 4 years. So you can, so it's kind of automatic that the government's policies change quite often.
Mm-hmm. A call for the government to have a long-term vision. Are there any questions in the audience so far? You can raise your hand or Emily will come to you.
I had a question. Twice already you said that you also want to inspire other parties in the markets to improve, to have more regard for sustainable finance. How's the response in the market? Are they actually saying yes, or is it still a very, very hard job?
I would say that my colleagues, the other banks, my brothers from the other banks, they respond quite positively. I think personally the bankers really would like to go that direction, but things go slow and other priorities, things like that. But if you look over a longer period of time, that we sometimes now discover that the text of our advertisements of 10 years ago are almost literally used now by ING or Rabobank or others. And I do think they do reflect an higher level of consciousness for sustainability. And the other fact what helps is that it's one of the growth markets. So many markets are not growing, but sustainability, the whole transition of our economy to a more sustainable economy is a real market for banks they look at. So that all helps. And I think the financial crisis, last but not least, is something where bankers start to realize that they have a societal role. Where when just the crisis happened, I know that some of my colleagues said, we are not an NGO, what are you saying? But now it's very clear that they have a societal sort of for the common good role as well, and they have to deal with that. And I think that's positive. I mean, it's a long way to go, systems change step by step, but I do think there's a lot of goodwill there as well.
Thank you for your question. Are there any other questions? Yes, the last one for now.
I would like to know, are banks changing fast enough, and especially because of existence of platforms like TransferWise, but also Kickstarter and stuff, what is the true role for the future, because change is coming and it's coming fast.
The role of banks in the future,
yeah,
that's
so
a big question.
Yeah.
It's for Mr. Blom or for Mr. Bates?
Mr. Blom.
Yeah.
I think that we get a much more diverse financial system, what means banks will be part of that, but it will not be only banks. I think it will be much more diverse. I think that's healthy. You need an ecosystem of finance supply, yeah, and they should help each other, crowdfunding, other forms of money, and I think that's a very healthy thing. I personally believe the Dutch banking sector, for example, has become too big. It's four times cross-national products, and it's really, really big, and I think it should be more diverse, and I feel then there is still a role of banks. There's a lot of know-how in banks about risk management, about sector knowledge, what we should not throw away, use it, but maybe not in the way we did in the past, maybe much more closer to the real economy. The original sort of role of banks.
Mr. Batesman, you want to respond?
I agree with that. I think I see indeed the landscape, the financing landscape, I see becoming much more diverse. I think, well, it's also because banks have not had a very good press, generally speaking, in the past 10 years. But also because, for example, in the case of the Netherlands, there are questions about, you know, the mortgage financing, which is kind of, you know, the mortgage financing is much bigger than the amount of deposits that the banks can attract. And so more of a role, and actually the requirements on banks are tightened, so more of a role will also go to, say, pension funds or big institutional investors, to insurance companies, to provide some of the financing activities that the banking sector traditionally does. And in addition to that, you have crowdfunding, etc. And probably also the capital markets will become more important in the future, because I can imagine with better communication, with a wider spread of potential ownerships of stocks, that it becomes more and more interesting also for smaller firms to go directly to the capital market.
Yeah, interesting. Thank you for your question.
Let's zoom in on the role of the banks within sustainable finance. You spoke a lot about your colleagues. Is it really true that you call Ralph Hamers, for example, from ING, or Gerrit Zoon from ABN AMRO, and discuss with them how they're doing about sustainable finance?
You want to know some.
Or they're calling you.
Well, I see them regularly, and yes, they know where we are standing for, and they can see that we grow and are successful, and sometimes we share some ideas. Yes, that's happening. And I mentioned one about green mortgages. Mm-hmm. So in that sense, I think they're quite open to that, but they also have to deal with some of the issues of their own institutions. Mm-hmm. You better ask them how they deal with that.
Now, when we look at the Eerlijker Bankenwijzer, which has been published last year, we see actually that they're quite satisfied with the direction banks are going when it comes to sustainable finance. What is your opinion on that? Are the big banks moving also fast enough towards a sustainable finance sector?
I don't think it's fast enough if you look at the problems of the planet. I really think we are in a climate crisis, what I think is an economic crisis, but with a longer term effect. Short term, it looks all sunny and nice, but we know in a couple of years things really will become worse and we have to do something. And if you take that urgency of the question, how do we transform in the next 10, 20, 30 years our economy and the time it takes, we better should have started yesterday. Mm-hmm. So but I feel the sense of urgency is not enough yet. There should be much more sense of urgency and come up with new ways of combination of pension funds, banks and crowdfunding, and find more coalitions who say, well, not in the next 10 years, but next year we're going to do this thing.
And what do you think, Mr. Beetsma? Yeah.
Well, I think those big banks are kind of maybe also somewhat bureaucratic organizations. So the change in thinking is very slow. They have their lines of business, they have their existing products. So for them, it's very difficult to change fast. It's kind of similar as we saw in the airline industry. We have the big parties, the KLMs, Air France, and then there is EasyJet, which comes with a new concept, and it conquers the market. And I think also here, maybe we should expect more from new parties with good ideas, with fresh ideas that can appeal also to a big group of consumers. Then we can expect from those big banks. Those big banks, they will change, but they will change only slowly because they are big organizations that are not used to change.
Yeah. No.
Are those banks changing because they think it needs to change, like they need to change their core values and norms, or are they changing because they see a good market within sustainable finance?
If you ask me, I think it's mostly market driven. If they see that parties like Triodos grow very fast in this segment, then of course they want to copy it. And I think this is what kind of drives their willingness to change.
I have a quote from.
I should not underestimate the new people coming in the banks. People coming from university like yourself. Yeah. Want to work in a bank, they have a completely different approach to banking. They want much more the bank to be serving other entrepreneurs, society, and in that sense, I also think it's a generation. A new generation with a new approach to banking can really help, and then it can go very fast.
How is the new generation changing Triodos?
I think it's changing in the sense that they're much more sensitive to technology, new change in technology, but also what I very much like, they want to go deep down, they want to know exactly how it works. So the transparency element, show me, tell me, explain me, and come up with examples, gives us a different dynamic than just copying what the older guys did in the past.
And what do they have to learn from the older generations maybe in the banks?
It's difficult to say. That's what they should tell you, actually. I think the older generation maybe is the experience you have as entrepreneurs. I mean, like granting a loan to an entrepreneur is not something what you can learn theoretically. You have to do it 1,000 times, and then you sort of know what the risks are or who should. And I think that's what I personally learned over the many years I've been in banking, and become sort of more balanced in my view how that can work. And but they're interested in that as well. I mean, it's not that they deny that they're very interested in that.
I had a quote from the CEO of ING Bank, Ralph Hamers, and he says, "One of our key beliefs is that sustainable business is better business. We designed a really unique offering here based on our approach to integrate sustainability and grow green markets throughout all products and sectors. The success of our first green bond issue shows that investors believe in our approach. This really takes sustainability to the next level within ING." So is this something, is this window dressing, Mr. Beetsma?
I'm not able to say that. I don't know ING well enough to say that. I think if you ask me, green bonds or green investments, I think they can be better business than traditional investments, because enough people want to invest in those, then automatically it becomes, the returns will be, or the prices will be higher of those instruments, and it will pay off. But whether this is window dressing, I cannot say.
What do you think, Mr. Blum?
I think what he's saying is correct, but it's still very small. Mm-hmm. And he said it's for ING an important step. Mm-hmm. What can I say against it? Mm-hmm. Yes, it is an important step for them. But I think the danger is if financials start to create financial instruments without a real economy growing, the green real economy growing, then you create also bubbles. So also green bonds can become bubbles. So we have to be very careful as banks, but we think we can change everything ourselves. It's only in close relation with the real economy who has to do the transition that it can work. So in that sense, I'm always a little bit hesitant to look at our own balance sheet as sort of the measure of change. Mm-hmm. The measure of change is with our customers. That has to be very clear.
So the big banks are changing, but they're not changing fast enough. Their policy is not changing fast enough. So the change needs to come from newcomers to the game or smaller players. As such, Triodos is one of them. What has also been said by you is that Triodos is growing so fast, you actually can't handle all the savings which are coming into the bank. Can you explain that quickly?
Well, what you see today, it's relatively easy through internet banking to move your money from one bank to the other. That's one of the big benefits of technology. Mm-hmm. And many people feel, I want to change bank and come to us. But to give a loan to a company is not a thing you do overnight. It's something you look very carefully into. That takes time. The whole transition of the economy takes time. Mm. So taking all this money from the savings one-to-one to loans is a very challenging task for the bank. Mm-hmm. And for the moment, the savings are growing faster than the disbursement of loans. And still we grow quite significantly with our loans, 15%. But savings grow even more, 20%.
Does this mean sometimes you have to make a trade-off and also make investment in non-sustainable projects?
We don't. We feel that's not our task, that's not our mission.
But you do store your money in other banks, which are not sustainable.
Well, with today regulation, you put your money at the ECB in Frankfurt, where you have to pay to place it, 40 basic points, 0.4%. So that's a costly adventure.
I think there are two things in my perception that are relevant also here. One is savings are now high because economies are still not growing, or they are growing, but they are growing very slowly. Consumers, they don't want to spend money, so what they do is they save. And so that is one. The second is you need to kind of place those savings. And I think also here, we run into an other problem, and that is, I think, that the amount of human capital that is available to do these tasks is kind of quite limited. And I think this is a problem that will become worse in the future, because we have an aging population, but we need more and more knowledge workers to do these type of things. I agree that placing loans in firms or wherever, it's not an easy thing, and it's becoming probably, it's becoming more and more sophisticated. So you also need to have better and better knowledge to do this properly.
We have a question from the audience.
Yes, it's for Mr. Beetsma. You advise pension funds like the detailhandel you mentioned, and overall you seem rather positive on sustainable finance, whether that's on a long-term stability or more the sort of people, planet, profit definition of sustainable finance. And I was wondering, how do you advise your, or sort of the pension pod you advise, do you also advise them to divest in, for example, fossil fuels, or invest more in, let's say, green finance?
What is your advice to your pension fund?
Well, I should say I'm a supervisor of the pension fund, and I'm not in the board of the pension fund, so I don't take decisions. But of course, we have discussions about this. And because sometimes the board and the supervisors are having meetings together, and we discuss these issues. The responsibility is with the board, but if we think that they take maybe uncautious decisions, then of course we advise them. If they and we also advise them without them asking us. But we discuss these things openly, and before I joined the supervisory board, we already had in place a policy of investing responsibly, and I think at the moment we are also we are reviewing this every couple of years. I think that we can also get more and more information about the companies that we are investing in, and so we can maybe change our, if necessary, we can change our investments.
So if you were in the position, would you advise them to sort of divest fully in fossil fuels? Like the movement is actually like global.
Divesting in fossil fuels. Thank you.
I'm not sure that I would go that far at the moment. I don't know whether they actually invest in fossil fuels, but it's quite a big part of the economy. But I think in the longer run, fossil fuels will become less and less important, and it's also possible from the perspective of the spread of your portfolio to move away from investment in fossil fuels. I'm sure they look at. If there are investments in fossil fuels, I'm sure they look at the reputation of the companies they are investing in and whether they are doing responsible policies.
Thank you for your question. Do you agree on it, Mr. Blom?
About disinvesting from fossil fuels?
Should you give? What would your advice be?
I think we do not fossil fuels for some time already. Because we don't believe it's a secure investment longer term, and it doesn't match with our mission to have a more sustainable economy. So that's a simple reason.
You only invest in projects which are good for the planet, the environment, and the people. Yeah. But at the same time, you also mentioned the fact that it takes time to find projects which are matching your criteria. On that note, can ABN AMRO, ING, SNS, can the big banks change their direction as you do it with Triodosbank, and still be a big bank? Or is there a limit to how big a bank can be and still do sustainable finance?
I think that is the theory of change, how that works. Mm-hmm. And it's true that if you have been founded to be a sustainable bank and be a catalyst for others, that you have a different role than they are a big bank who's already there for 100 years. So I do think they have a different path of change. Mm-hmm. But I do believe with Catalyst trying to show that things can be done, and that was very much and is very much our role as Triodosbank, that they can include parts of what we do in their own policy, and it's really up to them how fast they do it, how what sort of pace of change they choose. But I think they're much more closer to the general sort of pace of society where change is possible, where we can go much faster. That's a fact of life. But what I hope that they're not behind the pace of society, like what happened to our politicians. I feel business and society is much more ahead in their thinking about sustainability than the politicians were 10 years ago. That was the other way around. So that's even more a question to our government and to our politicians than to the banks and to business.
But in the case of Triodos, can you grow as a bank still?
Absolutely. We have no problem to grow.
But still you are lagging behind with finding projects which are sustainable.
Well, we grow now with 15 to 20% a year, and that is from a business perspective. We're also a business. We are not sort of like an organization who can fastly grow. It's quite a challenge. We get quite a lot of new people in. We grow not only in the Netherlands, but also in 5 other countries in Europe. So that 15, 20% growth is what we can handle. And what we hope there will be more colleagues doing the same, so that together we become a much bigger movement. And that's why we created this Global Alliance for Banking of Values, that we have more banks, smaller, mid-sized banks going in that direction.
Mr. Beesman, you want to respond?
Well, actually, you were saying what I was wanted to ask is, so Triodos is active abroad, apparently.
Yeah. 6 countries in Europe.
Because you're talking about the potential for growth, but we are only the Netherlands, and the Netherlands is a relatively small country. So I think there should be a lot of potential for growth outside the Netherlands. And I think now we are still in an economically difficult situation, but when the financial markets get more integrated again, also in Europe, which I think in some day will happen, then it will also be easier for parties like Triodos to expand their activities also in other countries.
Yeah, we've seen sustainable finance is becoming more popular. Why? How come Triodos is not as big as SNS, for example, in the Netherlands?
I think because SNS is a much older bank and has grown with a lot of mergers of saving banks in the past. And the saving banks has been always very big in the past. Actually, I think they really are less big as they were if you all combine them.
So is it possible for you maybe to merge with ASN Bank, for example, to become bigger, to have a bigger impact in our society?
I don't think we would have a bigger impact if we merge. Sometimes it's much better to have different offerings from banks with different identity, and together you can grow the market. I don't believe that with one big bank you change the market. Probably it's a much more interesting market also for the consumer if there are sort of 5 or 6 banks like Triodos Bank, but with a slightly different profile. I think we should celebrate more diversity also in sustainability. And we really appreciate the colleagues of ASN what they are doing and what we are doing, and together we can grow that market, and maybe more will come.
Let's talk about this diversity within sustainable finance and sustainable investments. When I looked at your site, it is mentioned that you also do investments with Orthodox churches. What is sustainable about these investments?
Well, it's not so much the fact that they are Orthodox, but we do believe that a diverse cultural life, religious life, is important in a free country, and we are a free country.
I agree, so, but what is sustainable about it?
I think that is sustainability. Sustainability is not only about the environment. Sustainability is also about a diverse social ecosystem, with people having different religions, but with respect for other religions. Yeah, yeah. So we have a very clear policy. If we do finance a church, we really check very carefully how their respect is to other churches, to other beliefs.
The Triodos has a very green image in the Netherlands as a bank. Are your consumers aware enough, you think, that you also have these kind of investments?
Absolutely. We publish about it, we discuss it, we get questions about it. So, absolutely.
They are aware enough. But also the people who are coming from ING or ABN, they think, well, you have a green bank, but they also do these kinds of projects.
Yeah, they can have a look at that, and I can see. And we actively promote that sustainability is not just about green. That is a very 90 vision. Mm-hmm. I mean, we are living in 2016. Sustainability is a much more integrated approach to society with the social dimension as well. And I would say also the cultural dimension. A diverse cultural life is very important for a healthy, sustainable society.
So there, just to top on this topic, you're mentioning that diversity is a different aspect of sustainability. Does this mean that you sometimes make trade-offs when it comes to diversity or environment? So in a sense, does the church need to have an A energy label if it wants an investment?
Well, that's the interesting part. That's the interpretation. If you have the broader perspective, that sometimes the entry point is green, mm-hmm. and you ask, but how are you socially organized? How do you treat your employees? How open relation do you have with your customers? And if you talk to a church, for example, you'll say, well, what about your building? How green is it? And that are the interesting entry points for us to have a much more integrated, sustainable picture. And actually, that's also what Ralf Hamers was referring to. It's much more about integrated sustainability and not just a one-dimensional way of looking at sustainability.
I think we have an audience question. We have time for it?
Yep. We have three audience questions.
Okay.
Short, please, because we are running out of time.
That'll be difficult, so I'll try and be as fast as I can. I have to premise my question with a few statements.